So, you know, my thought is down, you know, for another year or two to start asking my administrators and directors of nursing to start writing their own 2567 to see where they predict it's going to be. You know, we know what the data is, we know where we've worked, so now what do you think it's going to find? So that's sort of a challenge I think we're going to do in a couple years with them. We're sort of planning out.
I guess our first QIS survey, we had four deficiencies, primarily in nursing. And as you know, QIS looks at all of the regulatory groupings, so that goes in favor of nursing, so they're looking at all areas, all regulatory areas. In our most recent QIS survey in February of this year, we had three. And the good thing about that was, again, if I go back to the top 10 QIS deficiencies in the state of Florida, the majority of them are related to those critical element pathways, the five elements, the 281s, the assessment, the care planning, the revision of the care planning, in addition to that, the unnecessary drugs. So out of that top 10, there's probably eight of them that are nursing-centered deficiencies. And for the 27-year history of our building, for the first time, we received no nursing deficiencies. Three minor deficiencies, but no nursing related. For the last 2 years, we've had no care planning issues. And it gives you the opportunity with Abaqis, when you pull down 6 months of MDS data, so you can look at this for the first time, it's just remarkable. It's incredible. And you use that information. So for me, it's had a very positive outcome as far as the survey process and reducing our deficiencies. And so our goal is the next time to go down to obviously zero deficiencies.
So Jackie, the zero deficiency
well,
folks
I'm gonna
help
take it. Credit for my facility having zero.
I think that's great.
They did work hard for that. And I mean, I can't say anything negative about it because I mean, it followed Abaqis, we followed mm-hmm. Abaqis, it followed, the survey followed Abaqis. We did have some surveyors who didn't know how to use their computer, but other than that, and we are electronic, we're fully electronic, so we have mm-hmm. a little advantage because they have to ask us for info. They don't just have access to our information. I just think that Abaqis is a proactive way of finding out smaller issues before they develop into huge issues, and then you've got angry families, you've got angry residents, and the more you ask them the questions, the less negative information you get. Each time you ask it, it seems like you mm-hmm. get less negative information, as long as you address the negative issues the first time you ask. When you come back, there should be no issues, and I think that's key, is getting your information and then doing something about the information that the resident gave you or the family gave you. I think that's key in making the whole Abaqis system work.
Well, that was the same survey that I'm involved in. Jackie and I worked together, and she does get full credit for it.
Well, not full. I'm taking credit here.
No, I mean, her team does, the nursing team. But I think what she hit on there is the key is doing something about it after you ask the questions. Because if you don't do anything about it, then the next time you ask it, it's like, well, I already told you and you didn't do anything about it, and then they're just more angry. So you do have to address it and fix the issue. And most of the time, it's very simple issues. It's things we just didn't know. So it's pointing out to the staff, you know, what is it that the resident really wants, and once you figure that out and then you can take care of it, it's like, wow, well, that was simple. And that's the case most of the time. Sometimes it's not that simple, but the coffee issue that he brought up, we actually changed our coffee system in all three of the buildings because we found out that the CNAs a lot of times just didn't have time to stop what they were doing and go make a pot of coffee up on the halls because we have multi-level buildings. So it wasn't as simple as just walking to dietary. They had to go downstairs to get it. So now we have automatic coffee machines where they just push the button and it gets the coffee. So it was a real quick and simple step, something we really never thought about before. So now they can get the residents coffee, and that eliminated that as a concern throughout the whole building. So doing something about it is a key.
I'm glad the coffee issue just wasn't me specific but I think it's funny when you start really hearing mm-hmm. what the residents mm-hmm. want.
And you hear it from the people who are very low key.
Right.
I think that, I mean, you've got your complainers, and we all have our complainers, and we know what their issues are, even if we fix it. But I think you get information from the low-key people that would never speak up if they weren't asked.
Along the line of choices, which is, you know, goes back to the resident voice, those are where we've identified, you know, not only local issues, but system issues, mm-hmm. to, you know, and some of that goes around the time you go to bed or the time that you're woken up. So we're trying to get, you know, more, they're implementing more of a scripting, mm-hmm. to see, you know, we could be waking you up, we could be getting up earlier or later, what time would you prefer? You know, I mean, it's hard in a nursing facility to always be able to give exactly, you know, because you got competing, you know, residents and things that are going on. But, you know, some of it is how you approach it in terms of how you offer the choices that you can do. So, and so there really is a shift that is going on right now in mm-hmm. some of the facilities, you know, particularly around the resident choices. But, you know, those are great things. You know, some things are local and some things are system issues. Mm-hmm. And we have some units we know we may have problems at. And the staff can't fix it themselves without, you know, administrative or other sorts of supports.
One of the things we found was on bathing. That was a key. And I know nobody does this because we all did it 100 years ago. But, you know, this room gets, you know, showers on Monday, Wednesday, Friday, Tuesday, Thursday, Saturdays. You know, this one's showered every day. But, you know, we all sit on day shift. And we, you know, push the GNA to have, you know, six showers that day for their residents. And it was just craziness. And you talk to the residents, well, you know, they wanted the bath at night. Or they wanted their shower at night. That's what they were used to for 35, 40 years. And of course, they come into our building and we're gonna stick, because they were in room 302, they're gonna get a shower at this point in time and not when they want it. So, you know, we sort of looked at expanding how we schedule things and how we ask residents for stuff. One of the things that's a challenge that we've sort of talked and mulled over and over with MDS 3.0, and I know nobody else has had this issue, is, you know, we all get admissions at 8 o'clock at night, and of course you want to start rehab immediately if you can. So, you know, and what if they're a late sleeper the next day? You know, a lot of our initial rehab evals are done early in the morning. So we've sort of scripted it saying, hi, welcome, you know, tomorrow morning is an early morning if it's okay with you, and you can expect your rehab so we can get it started early. And we've modeled it, and it's worked so far, and we're hoping it's gonna continue, because one of the things we don't wanna do is shoot ourselves in the foot by saying, okay, we need to get the rehab done, and you need to get in there and get that eval so we can treat and get some minutes in case they would happen to go out to the hospital, God forbid.